बोलो हरे हरे
जगना भया हरी Yeah. Bye.
accepting our lives to be the
fancying ourselves to be the possessors.
Accepting our lives to be the possessors and doers. Our freedom consists in orientating our desire either towards the ignorant material misconceptions or the true spiritual conception. We can easily attain the true spiritual conception by recognizing the super self, Paramatma, to be our friend and guide, and by dovetailing our intelligence with the superior intelligence of Paramatma, the super self and the individual self are both spirit, and therefore the super self and the individual self are both qualitatively one and distinct from matter. But the super self and the individual self cannot be on an equal level, because the super self gives direction or supplies intelligence, and the individual self follows the direction, and thus actions are performed properly. The individual is completely dependent on the direction of the super self, because at every step the individual self follows the direction of the super self in the matter of seeing, hearing, thinking, feeling, willing, etc. So far, as common sense is concerned, we come to the conclusion that there are three identities, namely matter, spirit, and super spirit. Now, if we go to the Bhagavad Gita or the Vedic intelligence, we can further understand that all three identities, namely matter, individual spirit, and the super spirit, are all dependent on the Supreme Personality of Godhead. The super self is a partial expansion or plenary portion of the Supreme Personality of Godhead. The Bhagavad Gita affirms that the Supreme Personality of Godhead dominates all over the material world by his partial representation only. God is great, and he cannot be simply an order supplier of the individual selves. Therefore, the super self cannot be a full representation of the Supreme Self. Purushottama, the Absolute Personality of Godhead. Realization of the Super Self by the individual self is able to realize the Supreme Personality of Godhead by intelligence, by the help of authorized scriptures, and principally by the grace of the Lord. The Bhagavad Gita is the preliminary conception of the personality of Godhead, Sri Krishna. And Srimad Bhagavatam is the further explanation of the science of Godhead. So if we stick to our determination and pray for the mercy of the Director of Intelligence sitting within the same bodily tree, like a bird sitting with another bird, as explained in the Upanishads. Certainly, the purport of the revealed information in the Vedas becomes clear to our vision. And there is no difficulty in realizing the Supreme Personality of Godhead Vasudeva. The intelligent man, therefore, after many births of such use of intelligence, surrenders himself at the lotus feet of Vasudeva, as confirmed by the Bhagavad Gita 7:19. Om Jnana Dhamarandasya Dhamantana Sarakaya Jai Shri Krishna Chaitanya Prabhu Nityananda Shri Advaita Vedanta Shri Vasanti Guru Bhaktavinda Hare Krishna Hare Krishna 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 Hare 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 Rama Hare Rama 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 Hare. So Srila Prabhupada, well, the second chapter is directing us to contemplate the super soul, the Lord in the heart. The first chapter was describing the universal form, and the second chapter is contemplating the super soul. And Prabhupada is explaining to us how any intelligent person will understand that within the body there's not just one soul, but there are two souls. But you have many people, just like we know here, just like we know from our own sense that many people sometimes they confuse the soul and the super soul, and they think there's only one soul. They don't believe there are two souls. They think there's only one soul, and they confuse the super soul with the individual soul. So there's the monistic philosophy and the dualistic philosophy. Shankaracharya propounded, he taught the Advaita philosophy, Advaita, oneness, that there's only one soul. And he would quote from the Vedas, Sarvam Kalvidam Brahma, that everything is Brahman. So he made that Mahavakya, one of the great statements the Vedas, but the Vaishnava Acharyas, they minimize that. They say that's not the real conclusion of the Vedas. But Shankaracharya, he was important because he's Lord Shiva. And Lord Shiva had been ordered to bring back the Vedas, because before Shankaracharya, the Vedas had been removed, forgotten about, and there was no Vedic culture anymore, there were no Brahmanas, but it was Shankaracharya, who defeated the Gnostic Buddhists, and he brought back the Vedas, and he established also Brahminical culture again. Brahminical culture was removed during the time of the Buddhas. The Buddhas, they don't accept the Varnashram system. They just, everybody's equal. Everyone is equal. Well, everyone is equal in a sense that everyone is spirit. Everyone is a spiritual being. So in that sense, there's equality. But at the same time, there's difference. You can see materially, people are not equal. Materially, someone is rich and somebody is poor. And materially, somebody's healthy and somebody's sick. Materially, somebody is endowed with good karma and somebody else has got bad karma. So you see, materially, people are not equal. Although spiritually, so we have to understand that there's not just simply one soul, but there are two souls. There's the individual soul, and there's the super soul, the Paramatma. So this is the Vaishnava philosophy. All the Vaishnava acharyas accept this principle. You know, the four Vaishnava sampradayas are there, right? There's from Lord Shiva, there's one, then from the four Kumaras, and then from Lakshmi, and then from Lord Brahma. So these are the four Vaishnava sampradayas. And they all, I think, although there are differences in the philosophy between each of the sampradayas, there are differences, but they all agree that there's one Lord, one Supreme Lord, and the living entities are all servants. But Shankaracharya, he was preaching Advaita philosophy that there's only the oneness. And he was explaining the goal is to become one, to enter again into the Brahman, to merge what is called Sayujya Mukti. Sayujya Mukti, that is the goal of the followers of Shankaracharya, to become one. And indeed, when Lord Chaitanya met with Prakashananda Sarasati and Benares, at that time, when they saw Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, and they saw him so effulgent, they thought, oh, he's already achieved the oneness. They thought he'd already merged with the one, with the Supreme. Of course, Chaitanya Mahaprabhu was the Lord himself, so he was effulgent. But they were thinking he had become the Supreme. They didn't realize that he was always the Supreme. You don't become God. The impersonalist are thinking they can become God. But God is always God. God is never an illusion. That's why these people who present the Advaita philosophy, they're called Mayavadis. Because they say God has been put into illusion. So Maya is greater than God. Because if Maya can put God into illusion, then Maya must be greater than God. So this is how you got the term Mayavadi. That they're thinking Maya is the Supreme. So the Vaishnava philosophers, they don't accept that principle. And they say there's the eternal distinction between the Lord and the living entities. There's the Supreme Lord and there's the individual living entity. And they're compared to two birds in the tree. Just like in Vrindavan, you'll often see the birds, the green parrots, and they go into the tree. And when they fly into the tree, you could never see the bird, because the bird is the same color as the tree. It's green. So it's like the birds have merged Ma nel Chaitanya Bhavishyama Sarvivayam Ataparam. Never was there a time when I did not exist, nor you, nor all these kings. Nor in the future shall any of us cease to be. So Lord Krishna was speaking this verse to Arjuna. He was saying, I, Lord Krishna, you, Arjuna, and all of these kings. So first person, second person, and third person. Just like in English grammar, you have first person, I, second person, you, third person, they. So all, first person, second person, and third person, they're all eternally individuals. And we keep that individuality. But we have to understand that that individuality is not material. It's not the body which we keep. Your identity is not as a man or as a woman. That's not our identity, but our individuality, our identity is spirit. And that we're all spiritual beings, we're all spiritual entities, spirit souls. So we keep that identity. But, of course, we change the bodies according to desire. According to our desire. Whatever you remember at the end of life, you get a body. This body is our karma from the past. We've taken birth in a particular family, in a particular country, in a particular level of society, according to karma. So this body is being given to us. And in course of time, this body will dwindle and die. And then you take another body. You leave the body, you take another body. Because when at the time of death, the soul leaves the body, and the subtle body accompanies the soul. The subtle body means the mind and the intelligence. And they go, and they're the subtle body, and they accompany the soul, and they carry the desire of the soul to the next body. According to our qualification, what kind of body we want to get. So we have to understand that there are two souls. There's the individual soul and the super soul. The individual soul, we as a soul, we are trying to enjoy this world. We take birth in this world with the desire to enjoy and to exploit the resources of this world for our pleasure. That is the nature of the soul. The soul's nature is to be joyful. And we're looking for that enjoyment, we're looking for that pleasure by trying to enjoy the material world. Just like the bird in the tree, he's trying to enjoy the fruit of the tree. So he's eating the fruit. Sometimes the fruit is sour and sometimes it's sweet. So in the same way, we are looking for our pleasure in this world, and sometimes we're enjoying and sometimes we're suffering. We're not always successful. So the individual soul has to surrender to the super soul. When we surrender to the, just like we said, two birds. The one bird is eating the fruit and the other bird is the witness. So the super soul is the witness. He is described in the Bhagavad Gita, Upadrasta and Anumanta. Upadrasta means the overseer and the permitter. So just like maybe you work in a factory, you have an overseer, there's the supervisor, right? He's what tells you what to do. So in the same way, the super soul is watching. It's the overseer, the permitter. And he's telling us, giving us instructions, but conditioned souls that we don't like to hear. We don't take instruction. Although the super soul is speaking to us, we're not hearing. But when we surrender to the super soul, then we will take guidance from the super soul. So this is the idea that when we take shelter, when we surrender ourselves to Krishna, the Lord in the form of the super soul, the Lord in the heart, He will guide us. And that is also described in the Bhagavad Gita. Now Krishna is guiding us, He's guiding not only the liberated soul, He's guiding everyone, but He's guiding them according to their desire. In the Bhagavad Gita, Krishna says, from me comes knowledge, remembrance, and forgetfulness. So, in some cases, the super soul will give knowledge, and he will help us to understand things. And other times, he will give remembrance. He will remind us that, oh, you did that before, give you a lot of misery, a lot of pain. You know, you shouldn't do that. So like that, remembrance comes. And then forgetfulness also. Krishna allows us to forget so that we can try to enjoy. Sometimes you may act in the drama. So if you're in the drama and you have to act, maybe you have to be the enemy of someone. Now in real life, the person who is supposed to be your enemy in the drama, he may be your friend. But in the drama, you have to think he's your enemy. So you have to forget that he's your friend. So when you can forget your actual friendship, then you can play the part better. You can be a better actor. To be an actor, you have to forget who you are off the stage, and you have to enter into the mood, be that part, play that part. So this is the forgetfulness which comes from the grace of the super soul. He allows us to forget so that we can enjoy. If we remember, then we don't enjoy it. Just like people may smoke cigarettes and they think, I know smoking is bad for my health, but they don't like to remember. They just like to smoke the cigarette. So like that, so many things coming. By the grace of the super soul. The super soul is giving us this intelligence. It's a form of intelligence. And that intelligence is necessary to guide us out of the material world. So the people who follow the Advaita philosophy, the Mayavadis, they're thinking only one soul. They're thinking they themselves are, they say, tat tvam asi, tat tvam asi, that you are. The idea is that we're all God. I am you, you are me, and we are all one. We're all the Supreme. This is the Advaita or Mayavada philosophy. That it's all one, there's only the oneness. And the goal is to merge again into the oneness. That you are that. You are that. You're Brahman. But in the Bhagavad Gita, Arjuna says to Krishna that Krishna is not just simply Brahman, but Krishna is the Parabrahman. Right? Param Brahman, Param Dham, Pavitram Param Brahman. Arjuna, after Krishna spoke the Chatur Shloki in the Bhagavad Gita, was inspired and he understood that he was reminded of Krishna's position. And he quoted Christ Krishna, "You are the Supreme Brahman." So there's, we have to understand there's we are tiny, we are Brahman, but we're not the Parabrahman. Krishna is the Parabrahman. We are the tiny spark of the fire. The Parabrahman is like the fire. And that the Brahman, the living entities, they're just like sparks of the fire. So when the spark is in the fire, it's okay. But when the spark comes out of the fire, so the heat and light in the spark can be, if it falls in the water, it will be extinguished. If the heat and light, if the spark lands on dry grass, then maybe it can ignite a fire. But if it lands in the water, it will be extinguished. So this is the position of the living entity. Position is very precarious. That different things can happen. You come away from the fire, come out of the fire, and you don't know what will happen. So the living entity separates himself from Krishna, and we don't know what will happen. Well, we have to be very, very careful, because the living entity is tatasta, the marginal potency. That he can be in the spiritual energy, or he can be in the material energy. So if the living entity comes into the material world, he's separating himself from Krishna, he can get in difficulties, forgets his spiritual nature, and simply thinks of enjoying the body. And the Gyanis, or my valleys, they're thinking, well, I'm not the body, I'm soul, and there's only soul. And they think there's no variety on the spiritual level, there's no variety, there's only the oneness. There's no distinction between the Lord and the living. And they think when Krishna comes into this world, he is just a form of the Brahman. That he's also come from the Brahman. They don't accept that Krishna is the Swayambhuvan, that he is the source of Brahman. But in Bhagavad Gita, Krishna says, Brahmano hi pratishtaham. Krishna says, I am the basis of the Brahman. He doesn't say Brahman is the basis of me. That Krishna is the basis of Brahman. The Brahman is effulgence coming from the body of Krishna. So we see the difference between the Lord and the living entities, between the Brahman and the Parabrahman. The spark and the fire. Different, very different. One in quality, different in quantity. So for the Mayavadis, they say, there's only oneness, there's no difference. We just talk about the oneness. Everything is Brahman. And you are Brahman. We are all Brahman. Yes, we are Brahman. But Krishna is part. They cannot understand that there's the Supreme Brahman. So they don't make distinction. So Prabhupada concludes here, and he quotes the verse from Bhagavad Gita. Bahunam yamanamante yagavamam prapajante vasudesa paviti samahatma. After many births and death, when one is actually in knowledge, then they will surrender to me. Such as all the shrimp. So, the process of dhyana is like that. Mayavadis, they follow that path of dhyana. The impersonalists, Advaitavadis, the followers of Shankaracharya, they spend all their time studying Vedanta Sutra. They want to study Vedanta Sutra. Vedanta Sutra the end of knowledge, Vedanta, and sutra means condensed, put in a very short form. So they meet together and they contemplate what is being meant here. Vedanta Sutra was written by Vyasadeva. And the Mayavadis, they study the Vedanta Sutra. But we say Srimad Bhagavata is a commentary on the Vedanta. That this is the actual commentary on the Vedanta Sutra. But Shankaracharya, he wrote his own commentary on Vedanta. All the speculation. And all the Mayavadi sannyasins, they all study Vedanta. And they, when Lord Chaitanya was in Benares, the Mayavadi sannyasi said he was a sentimentalist because he was only chanting Hare Krishna. They were studying Vedanta, so they thought he didn't know Vedanta. But when they met with Lord Chaitanya, then they discussed Vedanta, and Lord Chaitanya explained the Vedanta to them. They were thinking he didn't know Vedanta, but Chaitanya Mahaprabhu taught them the Vaishnava conclusion of Vedanta. That there's a Vaishnava philosophy to explain Vedanta. It's not Mayavada philosophy. Some books are Mayavada philosophy. Srimad Bhagavatam is all Vaishnava philosophy. That's why the Mayavadis, they don't much like to read Srimad Bhagavatam. Because it's very clear Vaishnava philosophy. Misinterpreted, difficult for them to speculate. So they stay away from Srimad. Shankaracharya, he didn't write anything on Srimad Bhagavatam. He wrote commentary on Bhagavad Gita, but not on Srimad Bhagavatam. So the Vaishnava Acharyas, they have their commentaries on Vedanta Sutra, and they also glorify the process of devotional service, which is taught. Now sometimes Mayavadis also do devotional service. They will also speak about devotional service. But their idea is that you do devotion to become God, and then you give up. Once you merge, you become God, then you give up the bhakti. Just like they worship the deity, you can go to some temples and they're also reading Bhagavad Gita and they may be chanting Hare Krishna and they're worshipping Krishna, but their idea is to become Krishna, to become one with Krishna. They don't. They may speak about bhakti, but their idea is that bhakti is the means to become God. They're thinking the goal is to become one, to become the Supreme. So they want to give up bhakti. But actually bhakti is eternal. We say sanatan dharma. Then we do devotion here, and when we go back to Godhead in the spiritual world, we continue with devotion. We continue to serve Krishna. In the spiritual world, they're also serving Krishna. And they're also hearing the glories of Krishna. And they're reading Srimad Bhagavatam. They say in the higher planets, the demigods, they have their own Bhagavatam. The Bhagavatam here because it's eternal. It doesn't take birth and it doesn't die. It's eternally existent. But it changed, we change the body. The soul gives up one body, takes another body. And we go through all the different species of life. Some in the past we've had many different kinds of bodies. But the soul is always individual. It's never changed. It's not cut for anything. But it's covered. It can be covered. Just like the sun is covered by clouds. The sun is always in the sky. Some things will be cloudy. So the same way the soul is covered. The covering is that ignorance, the gunas, the modes of nature. Rajagun, tamagun, these things, they cover the soul. They influence the nature.
Then the mind and the body, subtle thing of the soul is equivalent to, let's say, a fire or a kindling.
Well, the mind and the intelligence, you see, you have subtle body, it's material. These are the elements. Krishna says in the Bhagavad Gita, earth, water, fire, air, ether, mind, intelligence, and false ego. Altogether, these eight comprise my separate material energy. So the mind, intelligence, and false ego are the subtle parts of Krishna's material energy. And they make up the body, the subtle body. So they're with us in the material world. But when we go back to Godhead, we give up those material elements. All those material elements, they stay in this world. When the soul is liberated to the spiritual world, then you don't need the subtle world. Because all of that, everything is there in the spiritual world.
Prabhu, since we are taking birth, dying, this process is continuous, so we are keeping all the memories of the past in this soul. But when we take a new body, we forget about the past. So we will not know what we have done it. So how do we clear those past and continue with the liberation in the Krishna consciousness?
See, we forget, we don't have the memories of the past, but we have the karma, we have the nature, the what we call the vasanas, that they're there due to the past.
Yeah.
So we all have a particular nature, we're attracted to different things. It's to do with our past, you see. So we don't remember everything, but we see how some people are, you know, somebody has the nature to be a businessman, somebody has the nature to study a lot, somebody has no interest in these kind of things. So everyone has their own individual nature, which is due to the past, but we don't have the memory of what happened in the past. But we can understand from our particular nature, our condition, what we've done in the past. What had affected us. So, these things are just, this is all just like covering of our consciousness. Krishna said in the Bhagavad Gita, when when Arjuna was asking Krishna that how could you speak the Bhagavad Gita to the sun god? Because the sun god is so much older than you. But Krishna told Arjuna that we have had many births. He said, I remember my births, but you don't. So that's the difference. Krishna, he remembers all of his births. We don't remember, but we know. But we have to understand what is our original nature. Our original nature is spiritual. But all of these different things which we have from the past, that was our conditioning. That was done out of forgetfulness of our spiritual nature. So we have to clean the heart. And that is chanting the holy name. That's why we chant. To clean the heart. Cheto dakshana marjana. The heart is like a mirror and it reflects everything. So we have memories from the past. And of course, a lot of memories we're not conscious of, but somehow they're there, but they're just covered over. Just like sometimes in the lake, you see there's a lot of things in the bottom of the lake. In India, sometimes they empty the kund. They have these different kunds. They have to empty the water out sometimes and take out everything which is there in the water and then put in fresh water. So our heart is like a mirror, and there's so much dirt on the mirror. You have to remove the dust from the mirror by chanting the holy name. The chanting of the holy name will clean the heart. It's like clean the dust from the mirror. So we have to clean the heart. And then you can see the real self. The real self, which is actually the spiritual self. So we want to come to that platform, to see ourselves as a spiritual being. Not just the things, the desires, the things, the thoughts we have, which are material. We want to understand our spiritual nature. So as spiritual beings, we have an eternal relationship with Krishna. And there are five rasas. Shanta, Dasya, Sakya, Vatsalya, Madhurya. We have some relationship with Krishna in one of these rasas. We have to cultivate our Krishna consciousness, and then we'll get memory, we'll begin to understand what is our rasa with Krishna. So it begins by cultivating the mood of Dasya Ras, being the servant. And as a servant, we cultivate the Krishna as the master, we are the servant. The super soul is the master, we are the servant. So we start to serve. And in the beginning, the service is hearing and chanting. Hearing the Srimad Bhagavatam and Bhagavad Gita, and hearing the holy name, and chanting, repeating, chanting the holy name, and repeating the glories of Krishna as we heard it. So this way we start to awaken our consciousness of Krishna. And as we go on hearing and chanting, one day Krishna will reveal to us how we can serve Him in a particular way. How to serve Him. Either as a servant, or as a friend, or as a parent, or as a lover. Like in Pushti Marg, generally they will worship Krishna as a child. Right? They think of Krishna as the child. That since Kumarmila, when it's a child, they're in Vrindavan and they will cook the milk sweets and they will make the kheer and everything, and they will worship Krishna like that little child. Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, he thought more about worshipping Krishna as, in his Kishore stage, as a young boy, young man, Kishore, means about between the age of 10 and 15. So Krishna is Nitya Kishore. He doesn't grow old. Even though he stayed in the world for 125 years, he was still like a young man. Even though he had grandchildren, but he was like a young man. Didn't grow old because his body was spiritual.
So Maharaj, the basis is knowledge is revealed upon you through your devotional service, serving the Godhead. Then the knowledge is kind of revealed upon you, not something you acquire on anything else, something like that.
Yes, right. The knowledge is revealed from the heart. Krishna in the heart inspires us and directs us to serve in a particular way. Inspiration, we say inspiration. Where does the inspiration come from? It's not from the brain, it's from the heart. It's the super soul, the Lord in the heart. Sometimes great scientists or musicians or something, they're doing something and